The Stars and Stripes Show is brought to you by the U.S. Embassy.
Tacoma. It's Gabs FM Power to engage your world. This one is none other than DMX alongside Faith Evans. Back to back with Ja Rule, Ashanti, always on time. 11:09 is your time. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I go by the name King Swifty Swift, otherwise known as the prolific Bantsola. And you know every time you hear my voice on a...
The Stars and Stripes Show is brought to you by the U.S. Embassy.
It's Gabs FM Power to engage your world. Welcome to the Stars and Stripes Show, proudly brought to you by the U.S. Embassy in partnership with Gabs FM, talking shared health. And you know, whether we like it or not, COVID-19 introduced an interesting consciousness of health. It's important that you are conscious of your health. And this is why some of these topics are very important to both you and I. Look, health is wealth, whether you like it or not. I recently actually tested for sugar and other things. I wonder how many young people such as myself can say that. But hey, moving swiftly along, I'm a firm believer that I do not want the doctor to tell me how to live my life. I'm a firm believer of that. And of course, now today's topic is really important. We have with us the U.S. from the United States Embassy, Dr. Jared Omolo, who is the Deputy Branch Chief for HIV Services at the CDC Botswana. Dr. Jared, how are you?
I'm all right, thank you.
How was your day?
Great. It's
how was your week?
Okay, excellent.
You're winning. How's your health, actually?
Pretty well.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm not convinced, but we'll have that conversation shortly. And of course, the Chief Medical Officer at the Ministry of Health, of course, in the building, he goes by the name Reku Lamaduke. How are you, sir?
I'm good, sir.
How's your health?
It's great.
You see, Doc, let's try that again. How's your health, Dr. Jared?
Awesome.
Okay, fantastic. Gentlemen, thank you so much for sharing some time and coming into the show. And, you know, today we're talking shared health. I mean, the U.S. government and, of course, the BW government have an extensive history in terms of, you know, joining the fight against HIV. We've seen the fight against COVID-19. And, of course, today we're having an interesting topic. We're talking cervical cancer. I think this is one topic that, you know, Dr. Jared, you know, we often can take for granted in terms of cervical cancer. And I also want to bring in the husband and spouses to understand the importance of understanding this topic being cervical cancer. Talk to me about cervical cancer and please highlight its importance. Why should Swift know about cervical cancer?
Thank you so much, Swift. And first, of course, we're grateful for this opportunity to discuss about the public health monster called the cervical cancer. Cervical cancer, as the name suggests, is cancer that affects the cervix. The cervix is the lower part of the uterus, sometimes called the neck of the uterus, that connects to the vagina. It's an important reproductive organ and supports it, plays a role in the reproductive process. Unfortunately, cervical cancer is a big challenge globally. Actually, it's the fourth most common cancer for women worldwide, where we have over 600 cases globally and over 300,000 deaths from cervical cancer.
From cervical cancer, globally?
Yes.
Wow.
And it's the leading cause of cancer deaths in over 40 countries, especially in the African countries, including Botswana. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, the story is the same in Botswana, where it's the most common cancer among women and the leading cause of cancer-related death among women. Nearly one in three cancer deaths in Botswana would be due to cervical cancer. But the most important thing, and maybe that's what we want to talk about here today, is that it is preventable.
It is preventable.
Yes.
Let's talk prevention. I mean, look, I am a father. I am a husband, you know, and, you know, a lot of men, and I think, you know, you'll agree that men need to understand cervical cancer, at least have an understanding. You know, for example, I have a girl child who's 6 years old. I would be interested in understanding, you know, hygiene practices that I can, you know, operate in terms of ensuring that, you know, her health in the future is well taken care of. It's an important component. What's your take on that?
Oh,
Go ahead, gentlemen. We're having a discussion here. We're going to talk as men about cervical cancer, and you know, educate and encourage other men to understand that this is a concern. This is something that we have to understand.
Yes. I can say it's very important to know about this cervical cancer and about its prevention. Because the prevention is actually, in medical ways, we have categorized it into three stages. We have what we call primary prevention, and we have what we call secondary prevention, and then we have the treatment. So actually, this treatment is still under prevention, even though I'm saying treatment. I'm talking about the treatment under the prevention.
Okay, under the prevention. Yes.
So the primary prevention we have, where we will say education. You talked about a 6 year old.
Yes.
Education is to say to avoid early unprotected sexual intercourse.
Absolutely.
You know, we talk about multiple sexual partners because, you know, the cause is the HPV.
Yes.
So if it's from different, it's easier for somebody to attract it.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have immunization. So immunization, currently the government, they are immunizing.
Wow.
So we are immunizing the girls from 9 to 13 years of age. It's actually an on school strategy.
Wow.
But we also target those who are out of school as well.
Mm-hmm.
So that is immunization. That is part of the prevention, and we are using the quadrivalent type of vaccine. So and then now after that, we have what we call secondary prevention. In secondary prevention, now cervical cancer, it has pre-stage. That's why my colleague here was saying that it's preventable.
Yes.
And that pre-stage is very important, because at that pre-stage, there is no any sign or any symptom, you know? So we'll say from age 25, maybe up to as far as 60 or above.
Yes.
We do screening. The screening is we do pap smear. We do what we call VIA, which is the visual inspection under the acetic acid.
Yes.
And we also do HPV DNA collection.
Okay.
Those are the three types of the screening we do. Those screenings, they will give us the results that they are changes in the cervix, which will be caused by that virus. So and then after there are those changes, that's when now we will go to the third form of prevention, which is treatment. Then we will treat those changes that we are seeing in the cervix. The treatments also, they have mainly three types. We have what we call cryotherapy, which is using cold. We have thermal, which is using the heat, and then we have what we call LEAP, which is actually removal of those changes. So depending on which treatment somebody gets, it depends on the changes and certain criteria that the healthcare provider will use.
Wow. It's Gabs FM Power to Engage Your World. Talking cervical cancer, talking shared health on the Stars and Stripes radio show, proudly brought to you by the U.S. Mission in partnership with Gabs FM. America in Botswana. Dr. Jared, let me bring you in here. Of course, our colleague here did highlight on some of the prevention strategies. Look, we have young girls that are growing up. How can the cervical cancer be prevented? Just, you know, echo or amplify, you know, how we can ensure. Look, I've got parents listening to the show. I've got young ladies listening to the show. And I'm a big believer in prevention is better than cure. How can we ensure, especially, look, I'm passionate as a father to say, look, I want to be educated around these issues. I know, and my wife has educated me that, you know, a woman over the age of 25 must have a pap smear at least once a year. Talk to us about that.
Thank you again, Siv. I know when we talk about the cervical cancer statistics, they often paint a very grim picture. But we want to highlight the prevention component.
And yes, absolutely.
We talk about this grim picture because cervical cancer is really it's very common and causes immeasurable pain because it affects women at the prime of their lives.
Okay.
So Dr. Kula has highlighted the different prevention approaches, the primary, the secondary, mm-hmm. and the treatment. He yes. mentioned the HPV. So maybe yes. I can step up a bit and highlight yes. a little more about the HPV.
Go ahead, sir.
The HPV is a virus. Mm-hmm. It's a human papilloma virus. Mm-hmm. And in the course of a woman's life, many of them would get infected with a human papilloma virus. Many times it's cleared from the body, but unfortunately there's a proportion mm-hmm. of the women in whom the human papilloma virus, also HPV, will stay for a very long time and then cause changes in the cervical cells, which then manifest as abnormal cells and transforms to cancer eventually. Mm-hmm. So we do know that over 90% of the cervical cancers are due to the HPV. And so what we are trying to do in the different screening approaches is to make sure that we pick the HPV among the proportion of women in whom it has not cleared. And also, and that's where the HPV DNA screening, the mm-hmm. HPV screening comes in. Mm-hmm. Other screening approaches would include like the pap smear, yes. where we do cytology, we take a bit of we do a swab and investigate to see if the cervical cells are beginning to change, and there are different classifications that we use.
Absolutely.
If there is a change in the cells and there is what we suspect may then progress to become a cervical, full-blown cervical cancer, mm-hmm. then that is excised off or treated using the different methods that, again, Dr. Kula has mentioned.
But before we go on, how important is general hygiene? I mean, you know, general hygiene, how important is it for us to understand, you know, general hygiene with young girls, especially in terms of ensuring that and teaching them those practices of general hygiene? Is that an important component of prevention?
Yeah, it is important because the HPV virus, the human papilloma virus, it is transmitted by contact.
Aha, okay.
Yes.
Okay.
So as it's transmitted by contact, the main major mode of contact to the cervix, because you know the cervix is actually inside the canal,
yes,
will be by sexual intercourse. But we know that things like fingers,
yes.
things like where maybe somebody may be sitting in the toilet seat and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
So which currently comes to hygiene. You know, hygiene also may end up being one of the ways being done. If it's not done well, maybe one of the causes or increasing of the transmission.
Okay.
Because the transmission is by contact.
Uh-huh.
So with that, hygiene is also very key.
Absolutely. It's Gabs FM, Power to Engage Your World, talking Shared Health on the Stars and Radio Show. Feel free to engage with me, 395-6962. If you're a father, you must listen up. If you're a husband, you must listen up. I like to have these conversations to bring in men into the conversation because I call it the dinner table approach. It is important that we understand the hygiene of our counterparts. Yes, you wanted to say something?
Yes, so I just wanted to add a little bit more information because
yes.
there is the sexual transmission component in
okay.
the HPV.
Okay.
And so we have other risk factors around people who, women who have multiple sexual partners.
Yes.
And then the other important aspect to bring on board is the HIV infection.
Mm-hmm.
Earlier on, I mentioned the fact that some women are able to clear the HPV from mm-hmm. their body. But HIV, because of the immunosuppression, the immunosuppression elements that it brings.
Yes.
So there are those who are HIV positive would have a higher risk. And we have noted that up to 6 times the HIV infection increases the risk of cervical cancer by up to 6 times.
Wow.
And so you'd appreciate the prevalence, the burden of HIV in Botswana as in many sub-Saharan African countries.
Mm-hmm.
So with the care of HIV, of women living with HIV, we have people who are living longer, life expectancy has increased. And so that means we are having a situation where the great benefits in the HIV care may then result in having a bigger pool of women who are at risk of cervical cancer. And the data shows us that up to 60% of cervical cancer cases in the country occur among HIV positive. And that brings us, that makes us to focus a lot more on the, to really focus a lot more on the HIV positive. And that's one of the initiatives in the country that is being supported by the USG, by PEPFAR, CDC,
yeah,
supporting the Ministry of Health, partners, etc., to put together prevention measures and set up screening opportunities to get the cervical cancer in before it evolves into full-blown cancer. Not many cancers give us that opportunity, and that's why it's grim, but we do have an excellent opportunity. That's a silver lining in the cloud, because we do have a long period in which we can intervene before the cancer becomes invasive and full-blown. And that's why the public health interventions, the screening comes in and allows us to achieve this high prevention to reduce the burden of cervical cancer to the extent that sometimes we imagine working towards elimination of cervical cancer as a public health challenge in our countries.
Absolutely. It's Gabs FM, Power to Engage Your World. If you've just joined us, welcome to the show. It's the Stars and Stripes radio show, proudly brought to you by the U.S. Embassy in partnership with Gabs FM, America in Botswana. Dr. Jared, let me ask you this question. Let's talk about fighting cervical cancer. Let's talk about the role of Botswana, the Botswana government, health workers. You know, one thing that I think we tend to neglect of or take for granted is what health workers do to steer this country to a better Botswana. I think I'd also like to take this time to celebrate all of our national health workers that are working both in urban and rural areas. You know, Swifty Swift can salute you and celebrate you. What role has the U.S. mission played in prevention of cervical cancer? What has been done on the ground?
Thank you again for that. So the USG mission in Botswana, recognizing the public health importance of cervical cancer, has partnered with the Ministry of Health, with the other partners. There's BTEC, there's WHO.
Yeah.
And really the approach is to form a coalition that then implements the various prevention measures
like that
we have been talking about. At the heart of that prevention is the individual, is the woman who we want to be aware about cervical cancer and the fact that prevention opportunities are available. With that awareness, then they present themselves in the health facilities where the healthcare workers then play the next important role, which is making the information available to the clients and screening them and identifying the risks and the lesions and then treating before it becomes full-blown cancer. So the USG through PEPFAR, CDC has provided technical support, has provided financial support to make sure that we create more awareness, we build capacity, training the healthcare workers, providing education, mentorship, and really strengthening the systems, partnering with the Minister of Health through the National Cervical Cancer Prevention Program, and making the services available in the country, and sometimes also supporting outreach opportunities so that women can be reached as close to their homes as possible. So in the last 3 years, the USG through PEPFAR and CDC and USAID have contributed to the screening of up to 58,000 women against cervical cancer. And I dare say, and maybe Dr. Kula would concur with me, that that's a very huge contribution to the screening efforts in the country and making steps towards elimination of cervical cancer as a public health challenge. Out of those close to 60,000, 3,600 of them were found positive to have precancerous lesions, and over 80% of them were treated. So if you go back to the story and remember what you said, that up to two-thirds of the cervical cancer patients would go on to die, that is lots of lives saved. Mm. And so we are grateful for the partnership with the Minister of Health, with the government of Botswana and other partners to have a role to play towards saving lives in the country.
Absolutely. It's Gabs FM, Power to Engage Your World. Dr. Kula, let me bring you back into the conversation. From the point of view of the Ministry of Health and its partners, what is the government of Botswana and its partners doing to address and fight cervical cancer?
Yeah. The Ministry of Health, or the government of Botswana, is actually doing a lot. Great. I mean, we really appreciate a lot. There's a good track and history of the support from the US. We have the NGOs like UPenn when it actually started, and then from there it was Japaigo, and then it was BTEC.
Yes.
You know, it has reduced tremendously the burden of the cervical cancer in Botswana.
Fantastic.
And also there were a lot of things like myths. You know, some time back, when a woman had like a cervical cancer, they would be kept at the back of the yard, and you know, nobody seen them because of the horrific stuff. But because of the knowledge and that was impacted in the society,
yes,
it's really becoming much, much better. Not forgetting the healthcare workers.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
The soldiers on the ground. Mm-hmm. Currently, every district, what we call health district in Botswana, we have services for cervical cancer prevention and those primary treatments.
Wow.
So even if you go
to Marapo,
Gumari. Marapong is covered. Where's Marapong again?
It's in the north towards Nata.
We have it in Nata.
Yeah. If you don't have in Marapong, but it's fine. I'm glad.
Yeah, but Marapong falls Nata. Under Nata, right?
So if a woman is challenged, the government of Botswana has opened doors in the geographical location of these health districts.
Yes. Yes, and we are still growing to trying to make sure that from the district, now we are going to populate the district.
Wow, like fantastic.
Every clinic maybe to have it.
Fantastic. Yeah. Look, kings and queens, we're going to continue the conversation. Dr. Kula, let me give you this closing statement. You're a man who's worked on the ground. You're a man who understands the health challenges, the health burdens, you know, and you understand because you're interacting with doctors, you're interacting with a lot of women nationwide. Yeah. What would you like to say to Botswana in your closing statement, including joining the fight to end cervical cancer in this country? You did mention that prevention is possible. Well, how would you close your closing statement?
I will just say, you know, Botswana, Botswana,
thank you.
So I would like really to say this to them.
Era.
We as Ministry of Health, we are trying our best.
Yes, sir.
We may have also maybe our shortfalls now and then that we are working on.
Yes, sir.
But I also want the client, the individual, women and men, so that they can also try their best by coming to screen.
Yes.
And I would like the husbands to support. And especially when they come and we treat, we have whereby there's 6 weeks without sexual intercourse and stuff. So please, I will say, men, you know, if men support women, I think we will really go far.
Absolutely.
And I usually take this cervical cancer thing as a traffic light. You know, traffic light has green, and then it has yellow or amber, and then it has red.
Yes.
Green is when a woman is not feeling anything. No sign, nothing, they feel fine. That is the time to go and screen.
Aha.
You know?
I like that.
Yeah.
Like
even
that.
If the results are negative, you continue going screening.
Yes.
Amber is when we find now there are changes in the cervix.
Yes.
You know? And then we treat. Red is now when we find cancer, which is what we don't want. You talked about you believe that prevention is better than cure.
Yes, sir.
So let's not wait until we're on the red state.
Absolutely. Dr. Jared, your parting statement, sir?
So as a medical doctor, I have had the misfortune of encountering a woman in the hospital who is already at the red light, as Dr. Kula mentioned. That means coming when the symptoms are already manifest and the cancer has already spread and there's bleeding and all those. Unfortunately, by then, it's almost always too late. And so I do want to say that we have a great chance to prevent the cancer and prevent this death.
Yes, sir.
Cervical cancer is very common, like we mentioned, but it is preventable.
Yes, sir.
And no woman should die of it, because we do have opportunities to screen and prevent. And let's grab the opportunities. To all the men listening, please support your daughters to get the vaccination between 9 and 13 years. Support your sisters, your aunties, your mothers, and all the women in your life to get the cervical cancer screening. And the services are available across the country, as my colleague, Dr. Kula from the Ministry of Health, has highlighted.
Thank you, sir. Gabs FM, good morning. How are you? We lost that call, unfortunately. Please call back, 395-6962. My closing statement on this particular segment is, Borre, I'd like to encourage you, fathers, uncles, Borre, please get yourself educated. And as what rightfully said by Dr. Kula, is that, look, let's get involved and support our partners. Let's understand our partners. Let's ensure that not only our partners, but our daughters, as Dr. Jared said. Gentlemen, thank you to my two guests who are health, and you know what, thank you to the both of you for the great work that you're doing in line with health. I think that's one thing we tend to forget. I should be paying you more, but I will try and sort that out. Okay, bear with me. Get my leg out. I'll sort it out, because you know, whether we like it or not, health workers are so important to the future of our country. Whether you're a health worker Nata or not, what you do is so important, and I think we need to celebrate health workers a lot more. It shouldn't be once a year. It's something that needs to be done continuously, because a health worker can save the life of my daughter, my wife, and a lot, even myself. So thank you to the both of you, okay?
Yeah.
Fantastic. Kings and Queens, we're going to continue the conversation. And of course, you just heard from Dr. Kula Maduke, the Chief Medical Officer at the Ministry of Health. And of course, his colleague, Dr. Gerard Umolo, who is also the Deputy Branch Chief for HIV Services at CDC Botswana. Kings and Queens, we're going to continue the conversation shortly after this. I got asked the Shaje coming your way. Okay, my caller called. Gabs FM, good morning.
Hello, Dumela.
Motsadi Waka, please keep it short and sweet.
Erra. Hey, nyakia lebuha, yaka lintzili buwa di chalo, tana hasesa lona, hasesa hao, tehateha ele barotne di balon. Mikiri, kilebuha elabore rehore bare hute, kabo le zibu, ampo bare umene, popelo ase yari, yano hore, hone, rele banna re chanese hore re, rotloetse ebile re basadi le bokgaitse di a rona e go itlhola ba teste ba bone gore a gona le ga e le matshosetsi ape go ise go nne late. Ke a leboga a modimo le sego gatse ka thuto e kalokan.
Amen, amen, amen. Thank you, Motsadi Waka. Moving swiftly along, that's how we close this particular segment. We're going into Ask the Sharjah. Keep it locked.
Are you an outstanding young leader? Looking to be part of a dynamic network? Apply now for the 2023 Mandela Washington Fellowship. This is an opportunity for leaders from across sub-Saharan Africa to hone their skills through academic coursework, leadership training, and networking. Applications are due September 13. For more information, visit mwfellows.info/apply.
Power to engage your world is on 101.0
FM.
It's Gabs FM, power to engage your world. Casper Nyovest alongside Something Soweto. What a fitting song. Gabs FM, good morning. 395-6962. Please feel free to call back. And your time is 11:43 across the nation. If you're wondering why the prolific is on air, you're on the Stars and Stripes radio show, proudly brought to you by the U.S. Mission in partnership with Gabs FM. 11:43, we're going straight into Ask the Sharjay. This is where we address all your burning questions. Whatever you would like to ask the acting ambassador, feel free to follow the U.S. Embassy social media pages and you can get to ask any question you like. Her name is Her Excellency Amanda Jacobson, and this is what we had. How is leadership for you as a woman? Let's go. This is what she had to say.
Well, first of all, I'm really grateful for the leadership opportunities I've had and the mentors who have taught and invested in me, both men and women. You know, I think I have a big responsibility as a woman leader to mentor other women, both personally and professionally, and it's something I take very seriously. My former boss in the State Department was Ambassador Linda Thomas Greenfield, who is currently our United Nations ambassador. And I really admired how she always took time out of her busy schedule to meet with and mentor, you know, other young officers throughout the department, regardless of how busy she was. And I'm also grateful that the Department of State has really prioritized diversifying its leadership ranks, including to women. We have a really long way to go, but at least there are steps being taken.
It's Gabs FM, power to engage you all. Absolutely. Leadership is an important component. Let me take the score. Gabs FM, good morning. How are you?
Hi, how are you?
Complaining doesn't pay me. How are you, sir?
Thank you, sir.
Talk to me.
Yes. Hello?
Hello, sir. How are you?
Can you hear me?
I can hear you loud and clear, and the nation can hear you as well. Hello? Unfortunately, that line seems to be unclear. Look, the next question you had to ask, what type of extracurricular activities did you participate in during school years? This is what the acting ambassador had to say.
Well, I always did running, including track and cross country, so long distance. I love swimming, volleyball, and basketball. So it was just a good way to get out my energy and meet others. And then I also really participated in orchestra. I played the violin since I was 4, and it was just a great way to meet others and really refine violin playing. And I also, to earn money on the side, I always had a paper route, you know, getting up at 5 a.m. in the mornings to deliver newspapers in my neighborhood 7 days a week, 365 days a year. I babysat, and then I also taught violin lessons.
Oh, wow, fantastic. Congratulations, Amanda, thank you so much for being a part of the show and always willing to answer the burning questions that the people have to ask. We're going to move along swiftly. Your time is 11:46. We're crossing over into... What are we doing next? We are actually speaking to Chasing the Dream with Oabile Tau, who's going to be talking about Education USA. Look out for that conversation coming your way and do not change that dial. You're officially on the Stars and Stripes Radio. It's Gabs FM, power to engage your world. Unfortunately, we'd like to apologize. We cannot get a hold of her due to technical difficulties. But listen up. Please feel free to follow the Education USA website. You can Google it. I have had the privilege of, and I am part of the alumni. I went on the IVLP course. Look, Education USA has got a lot to offer the Botswana, whether you're a health worker, whether you're an entrepreneur, whether you're in the academics. Please feel free to follow all the U.S. Embassy social media pages. I know they've got recently one on the Pan-African leadership that I would like to be a part of. So feel free to be a part of it. Just Google Education USA. Go onto the U.S. Embassy website and feel free to engage with them. There's a lot of wealth of knowledge for you, me, and of course, this is an opportunity that the U.S. government offers for us in order to help our fellow Botswana. Kings and Queens, we're going to continue with the conversation shortly. Do not change that dial. And of course, it's a Monday, it's a Friday, so you are officially on the Stars and Stripes show. Listen, I've got a little something to give away. So if you feel free to call me on 395-6962, I'm going to play you one song, and then after that, we're going to do a giveaway. And let me tell you something, you want to be a part of this. Proudly brought to you by the Stars and Stripes radio show, America in Botswana. Look out for it coming your way. Ladies and gentlemen, good morning.
You
It's Gabs FM, Power to Engage Your World. This one is titled Break My Soul, sitting at number 4 on the official 40 on Gabs FM by Beyonce, taking us to 11:54. Listen up. Be on the lookout for Express Credit activation in your area. Express Credit will be at Buiteko Junction Mall in Soroe this Saturday, the 24th of September 2022. Join them at the Soroe activation and stand a chance to win yourself fuel vouchers and a lot more when you sign up for a loan. For more information, call Express Credit on 316-5512. Express Credit, money when you need it. Borrowing more money than you can afford can lead to severe financial difficulties. You're officially on the Stars and Stripes radio show, and I've got a little bit of time. I'm feeling like I need to give you my mpempe nyana, singwe nyana, something in nyana. Call me on 395-6962. And I would love to see if you're a father and what you've learned about cervical cancer and the importance of understanding the topic. This is a very, very important topic that we must save. You know, one thing, gender divide will take us nowhere. Whether we like it or not, if we're gender divided, the boat will only flow in a circle. Now, that's why I'm encouraging you and me to come into the picture and understand. Look, when you get home, if you're a father, call your significant other. If you're a husband, call your significant other and ask them, Mohatak, did you manage to do a pap smear this year? Have you also gone for screening? We are screening services. Actually, I didn't ask my doctor where the screening services are available within the country. Are you able to highlight where people can go for these screening services?
Yes, I can actually highlight.
Please do.
Before I'd said, they are actually all health districts, are there.
Yes, sir.
I'll just mention a few.
Yes, please do.
Everyone in Charles Hill.
Okay.
Gumari.
Okay.
Kasani. Tutume. Masunga.
Wow.
Bubonong.
Wow.
Sefare. Tokweng. Mahalape. Shoshong.
Wow.
Letlakeng. Letlakane. Lobate. Good Hope.
Totela Gourmento Warun has done a phenomenal job, right?
A lot.
I think sometimes we are often, you know, we need to say thank you, because access to such, you know, expertise in the health sector is so important. And, you know, I really, really think sometimes we've just got to say thank you to the health worker. Thank you to the Botswana government. And of course, thank you to the U.S. government. Without funding, without shared health, without these kind of strategies that bring, you know, skilled health workers on the ground, we would not be here. So it's important to say. Yeah. No, thank you so much. 11:57 is your time across the nation. Kings and queens, thank you so much for choosing Gabs FM. Remember, shared health. And you know, one thing that I think is important to say in closing, health is your responsibility. It is not Botswana government's responsibility. It is not the US government's responsibility. It is your responsibility. You are the parent. You must understand teaching this kind of situation or this kind of education to Bana Barona, because it is important that you understand that it is your role to protect our children. And if you are over the age of 18, it's important that you understand the kanse that are related to cervical cancer. Cervical cancer is preventable. Cervical cancer, you know, whether we like it or not, the book of life says ignorance is killing my people. It's one of my favorite phrases. Ignorance is killing my people, and knowledge is powerful. Yeah. You know, knowledge can ensure a better and a healthier society. Like I say, gentlemen, thank you so much for offering your time, your services, and will you be back?
Of course, thank you.
Yeah,
we'd love to be back to share more public health messages.
Absolutely. Sir, you'll be back?
Anytime you want.
I think you're a radio presenter in your past life.
Yeah, I'm a soldier. I'm here to serve my
I think you're a podcaster. I think he is in his past life somewhere to do with messaging. And I think it's important that health workers, you know, I'm thinking out aloud, but I think it's important for health workers. We need to do a Skillshare partnership with health workers to also introduce them to media and the importance of understanding media so that they can be empowered to do it in their locations. You know, it's not necessarily that they have to have a dependency on Gabs FM, but now we have Facebook, people have mobile devices, they can use that to go and say, look, understand 1, 2, 3, 4 about the health, you know, messaging, you know? I think that's an important thing to do.
Yeah, you know, to pass the message from one person to another, it's a skill.
Yes, sir.
That now and then it always needs to be resharpened and or even to improve.
Yes.
So that somebody understand and believe in it and actually take action.
And guess what? Dr. Kula said he's going to take care of my voice because he feels like that is my economic asset. And he's like, you know, after this young man, I need to take care of his voice. So let me tell you, I'm going for a voice checkup. Go for your screening, cervical cancer. It's the Stars and Stripes radio show, Shared Health. Congratulations and well done to the BW government. Congratulations and well done to the US government. Together, we can do more. Be the change you want to see. Ladies and gentlemen, good morning.
Power to engage your world is on 90.3 FM.
The Stars and Stripes show was brought to you by the U.S. Embassy.